those 66 chapters regarding the obedience of Allah and seeking the rule of Allah, which is part of Tawheed. And any Muslim who thinks that يعني, he doesn't have to refer to the rule of Allah, he is not a Muslim. You see, unfortunately, nowadays, the so-called liberals or orientalists or whatever, they think that Islam is only for the mosque. It's only a relation between you and Allah, and it's in the mosque. That's it. Outside the mosque, Islam has no say. Not in our economical issues, not in our social issues, not in the way we dress, not in the way we behave, not in anything. Okay? And this is a big rejection of Islam. It's a big rejection of Islam. Unfortunately, a lot of people are like this nowadays. And because of their ignorance, they say, we are proud, we are Muslims. You see. And they give charity, some of them build mosques, some of them give millions to do a lot of things. But when it comes to the rule of Allah and something which they don't desire to follow, they easily reject it and they say, no, we don't have to do this. Okay? And this is a rejection of Islam. Because Islam cannot be partial. يعني you cannot take part of it. You see. As Allah said, أُدْخُلُوا فِي السِّلْمِ كَافَّةً. You have to take Islam, all of it. You cannot leave anything out. You cannot say, I only take Islam for my worships. You see, no. So, inshallah, when we study this book on Monday and Wednesday, we will go in detail. The first chapter of this book deals only with three things, mainly. The first main thing is that Tawheed is the first obligation on everyone. And who disputes that? There are people who are innovators who say, no, the first duty is not Tawheed. The first duty is to look into the universe so that you become guided to the existence of God. As if people are doubters, okay? And this is only true for someone who's in doubt of his Lord, you see? But most of the people are not like that, you see? Most of the people, one way or another, know God. They know that He exists. Not only that He exists, they know many other things about their Lord, you see? Christians do, Jews do. Others do, a lot of people do that, okay? No whole nation throughout the history has denied the existence of God altogether, no nation. Only individuals in the past and individuals in the present. You see, that's why no messenger came to his people with this message. Let me guide you to God, that He exists. No, you don't find this in Quran. You see? You only find in Quran that the messenger came to the people and ordered them to worship God alone. That's the first order, and that's all the messengers in the Book of Allah. You see? And then another thing about this order, that worship Allah alone is a comprehensive order, not partial. يعني I've seen some books, one book called Manhaj al-Anbiya fi al-Da'wa, The Path of the Prophets Regarding Da'wa. And he pictures all the messengers as wrestlers with the rulers. That's all. Yani Nuh came to overthrow the ruler this time. And Musa came to overthrow Fir'aun. And this came to overthrow that. This is imaginary, you see. This has no basis in the Book of Allah at all. When does it say in the Quran that Musa came to Fir'aun and told him, I should be in your place, you leave. No. You see. And then if that was the case, why is it that prophets will come on the Day of Judgment with only few followers? And some of the prophets will come with no followers at all. Why? If it was like this, then every prophet would be followed by a lot of people. Because when you say my goal is to remove that ruler and sit in his place, a lot of people will support you because he wants to be your finance ministry and he wants to be your prime minister and he wants to be this and he wants to be that. And at least you'll have 30, 40 followers. You know? Some people would even follow you just because they don't have any job. And they'll be happy with any job, right? So that was not the case. The Prophet ﷺ says, a prophet would come on the Day of Judgment with zero followers, no followers at all. And he's a prophet. Meaning that his way of speaking was nice, his morals were high, he was a truthful man, an honest man, a generous man, a brave man, everything, you see? And no one followed him, you see? Why? Because the Prophet did not want people to be used for him and to reach and to sit in power. No, the Prophet wanted the people to worship Allah, to worship God. That's all, you see? And then it's not his responsibility to make them do that. You see? As Allah told the Prophet ﷺ, مَا عَلَيْكَ إِلَّا الْبَلَاغُ. It's only your duty, O Muhammad, to tell them the truth. That's it. You have no more authority. You see? And every prophet did that. You see? When Prophet Noah, felt that his people are not listening anymore. He gave them da'wah for 950 years, calling them to worship God. 950 years, you see. This is a big lesson, you see. 950 years of his life. Allah knows how long he lived, you see. So, this is too much. And no one followed him except 12. When did So, therefore, the prophets never came for limited causes like that, whatever it might be, whether it is to establish a state or to do this or that, no. These are duties in Islam that we should achieve. But before all that, our first obligation is to worship God alone and not to worship others besides Him. And to know the right way to worship God. This is the meaning of Islam. This is the meaning of Islam. So inshallah, on Mondays and Wednesdays, we'll go in detail in this book inshallah. And inshallah you will benefit a lot from it because the author has chosen the clearest proofs from the Book of Allah and from the sayings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If there are any questions regarding this subject,
Sheikh, when we say that our trust in Allah should be present without us ever looking at the world around us and the skies and the moon and the sun to further increase that trust, could that trust exist in our heart without us really seeing this?
You misunderstood what I said. Yes. Yani, we are encouraged to look around. In many places in Quran, Allah encourages us to look into His creation. You see, because the more you look, the more it guides you to Allah, to God, to His knowledge, to His wisdom, to His mercy, to all the perfections of Allah, you see. That's why the Prophet ﷺ said, لا تفكروا في الله وتفكروا في مخلوقاته. Do not think of the essence of God Himself, you see, because your thinking will not lead you to nowhere, you see, because we have no example of God amongst us. He is the only creator, the supreme being, okay? We only know Him through His book and through what our Prophet told us, which confirms the book, okay? That's all. Other than that, we don't know. But if we look into His creation, we will learn more about those same attributes and become more sure of them. And the more you know Him, the more you become obedient to Him. Why? Because loving Him depends upon knowing Him. And fearing Him depends on knowing Him. And desiring His mercy depends on knowing Him. And to obey God, those things have to be there. Loving God, desiring His reward and mercy, and fearing His wrath and punishment. All three. You cannot do just by one of them. All three, you see. Anyone who says, I only fear God, he doesn't know God. Anyone who says, I only love God, I don't fear God, he doesn't know God. You see.
What's the third one?
So three. Love, fear. Desire and His mercy and reward, fear. This is Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Alhamd means Al-Madh Ma'al Mahabba. So this is the love. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, the most merciful, the most beneficent. This is desiring His mercy and reward. Maliki Yawm al-Din, this is reminding you of the Day of Judgment, so you fear Him. And then based on those three, you say, Iyaka Na'budu wa Iyaka Nasta'in. So you worship Allah based on those three, you see. And Allah says about the prophets, وَكَانُوا يَدْعُونَنَا رَغَبًا وَرَهَبًا. That the prophets of God, they were worshipping their Lord due to desiring His mercy and reward and due to fearing Him. See, the prophets were the biggest in their faith. And yet they didn't say, we don't fear God. Everyone fears God. Without fear, you will be going around with all what you want, following your desires, you see.
I have a question.
Yeah.
In the Quran it says, إِنَّ اللَّهُ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا فِي قَوْمٍ إِلَّا يُغَيِّرُ مَا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ. What does that mean exactly?
إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. Allah does not change the status of a certain group of people until they change themselves. This has two meanings. You will not go from good to bad except by your own sins. Yani, when you are living a good life, okay, and then you sin, Allah might turn your goodness into evil, into something bad for you. Okay, but you earned it because you started it. Okay? And also, when you are in a weak situation, in a bad situation, you have to start changing as much as you can, you see. You lift yourself up as much as you can. You cannot just be lazy and put one foot over the other and say, oh Allah, do this to me, oh Allah, do that to me, you see. This is not Islam.
But when you actually do that thing, isn't that tawfiq min Rabbil Alameen by itself?
Yes, it is.
So doesn't it all go back to Allah?
It all goes back to Allah. But still, you are doing something, truly. Yani what you are doing, whatever it is your action. It's not Allah's action. It is your action. You see? When Allah says in Quran, وَمَا رَمَيْتَ إِذْ رَمَيْتَ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ رَمَى, that is a special situation. It's not general.
What does that mean?
That was in a battle of Badr, the first battle between the Prophet ﷺ and the idol worshippers. And in that battle, the believers were outnumbered 3 times, you see. The idol worshippers were 3 times more than the Muslims, and they had double the weapons and everything, okay? So Allah sent down angels, actual angels, to fight alongside with Muhammad and his companions. Okay, so the angels, the Prophet was ordered to take some dust and throw it in the faces of big men on horses, you know, like 10 or 20 of them coming, and the Prophet would do this, you know, and he would say something. Angels would kill them, you see. Not those dust. This dust doesn't do anything. If anything, it might cool them. What does it do? The dust doesn't do anything to them. Okay? So that's why Allah said, you did not kill them, O Muhammad, when you threw the dust. You see, وَمَا رَمَيْتَ means you did not kill them. إِذْ رَمَيْتَ, it means when you threw, actually. Okay? But Allah killed them. Okay? So this was a special case. It's not to be made general, you see. The Sufis misunderstand this. They think that if you get sick, you don't go to the doctor if you trust Allah. You don't seek medicine if you don't trust Allah. They think that is the meaning of trusting Allah. You see, the Prophet ﷺ said, لو توكلتم على الله حق توكله لرزقكم كما يرزق الطير تغدو خماصا وتروح بطانا. If you were to trust Allah as truly as you should, then He would provide for you as He provides for the little birds, for they get up from their nests in the morning with empty stomachs and come back to their nests at sunset with full stomachs. That's all they could do, those little birds. They got up that early and they left, and then they come back at the end of the day, and Allah provided for them. They came with full stomachs, okay? So this is the example the Prophet is giving to us. Another example, when a Bedouin came to the mosque and he said, O Messenger of Allah, I have my camel with me. Should I leave it and trust Allah and go and pray inside? Or should I tie it? The Prophet told him, tie it and trust Allah. You see, there is no problem. When you do what you can, you trust Allah by your heart. When you go to the doctor, that's good, that's beautiful, go to the doctor. Don't trust the doctor by your heart, trust Allah by your heart. You see? When you take the medicine, that's beautiful, take the medicine. Don't trust the medicine for healing, trust Allah. Okay? So you do what you can, and in your heart, you trust Allah. You see? That's the thing.
What how could we distinguish between the good Sufi path and the deviated Sufi path? For example, Sheikh al-Islam, Sheikh Abu Hamid al-Ghazali, rahimahullah, Hujjat al-Islam, he was in the Sufism path, but that was the, it was said by our ulama, the Sunni ulama right now, that he was in the good Sufi path, embracing both aspects. So how could we distinguish? What, where's the fine line?
يعني أبو حامد الغزالي رحمه الله went through stages. He tried everything. He went into the stomachs of the philosophers, as his student Ibn al-Arabi said. And then he fought the philosophers. Then he went with Ahlul Kalam. And then he fought Ahlul Kalam. And he wrote a book against them. And finally, he went into Sufism. And some narrations say that he died with Sahih al-Bukhari on his chest. Yani meaning leaving Sufism and everything else. Okay. And we wish, inshallah, that this was his final thing. Regarding good Sufism, we don't call it Sufism. Yani we don't want to call what is from Islam, from Sunnah, call it Sufism or whatever. Unfortunately, nowadays, when you hear Sufi, mostly you find people who worship the dead, and they call it tawassul or whatever. It's not only that they have some innovations in dhikr and this and that. No, not anymore. Whenever you hear someone Sufi, unfortunately, you will find them of this type. He worships the dead. He doesn't know he's worshiping him. He calls it tawassul and he calls it this, that. And you find him has all kinds of things which are in the books, you know. Just 1 month ago, I was sitting, and some old man, Kuwaiti, he started talking something nicely and things like that. Then he told me, what's wrong with supplicating to the dead? There is nothing wrong with that. I said, why? He said, this is tawassul. So when I explained to him, whatever it might be, he didn't accept. And then he said, Sharia al-Haqiqah. And in Islam, we don't have Sharia al-Haqiqah. We have Sharia. Okay. What Allah says and what the Messenger says. They don't have this. And then he said, no, but it means this and it means that, okay. So, and I don't know, and there might be some still Sufis who don't have great trick and this and that, but I don't see them. Most of the groups that we have met.
Isn't tasawuf in the Arabic language, هو صفاء القلب من كل شيء دون الله?
Yeah, they say that. Some say tasawuf from Suf, some say tasawuf from Safa, some say other things. Yani it's not one explanation, okay? But we tell them, whatever you are explaining tasawuf by, we have it in Islam. And the Prophet did not call it tasawuf, and Allah did not call it tasawuf. They called it tazkiyah, they called it something else. So why go into those things? Yani Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, when he was asked about Ihya al-Muddin al-Ghazali, he said ghalibuhu jayyid, because it deals with a lot of diseases of the heart and how to, you know, deal with them beautifully.
Amlikat.
Yeah. Ghalibuhu jayyid, wa fih ahadith da'ifa kathira jiddan. Okay. Wa mawad min al-sufiyya. You know, a lot of things. Yani. From Sufism. Those who know their belief, who can read it and only benefit from it, okay.
So there's no problem reading the Ihya Ulumuddin if you have the...
If you know your religion, you know your belief, you can be careful.
You can distinguish.
You can be careful and you can distinguish and you will benefit, you see.
Because I was speaking to one of the ulama of the Tazkiyah.
Yeah.
And he said there is no substitute for this book when it comes to Tazkiyatiness. Because the muhlikat, the destroyers of the heart, are all very well explained. And it's very well structured in such a way that it deals with each and every muhlika very well.
Tell them, where is the Book of Allah? The Book of Allah doesn't deal with the way, subhanAllah. Yani, the Book of Allah is the source of tazkiyah, okay? And then, what did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam do? Allah told him, لِتُعَلِّمَهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَتُزَكِّيهِمْ يُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ. So the Prophet did his best. You see, there are great hadith which show you how to purify yourself. Okay. If we didn't have Ghazali and his book, we would be fine. We would be fine. Plus, there are other scholars who cleaned his book from weak hadith and all this, and only left out the good things. Like Minhaj al-Qasidin by Ibn Jawzi, Mukhtasar Minhaj al-Qasidin by other scholars. And there are other books, beautiful books. Kitab Madarij al-Salikin by Ibn al-Qayyim. Beautiful book, deals with the hearts. Beautiful book. Miftah Dar al-Sa'ada, another good book. Many other books.
The book of Tawheed that we'll be covering inshallah in the future, can we get it from here?
Yeah, anywhere, any bookstore, they'll find it.
I have a question about the emphasis on Kitab Tawheed. Like, we have a lot of books that are earlier. Kitab Tawheed is a late, the Salaf, a late book, a revivalist book. You have like Ibn Abi Zamani, simple, clear. I think it's better than Kitab Tawheed in essence. You have Aqeedat Salaf, Ashab al-Hadith. When I read them, I sensed that they are more clear, more better, the categorization is more simpler. So I don't know why this emphasis, Kitab Tawheed is everywhere, not everywhere. So.
I tell you why the emphasis, and this is beautiful. You have Kitab Tawheed by Ibn Manda, which is very early. You have Kitab Tawheed wa Sifat al-Rab by Ibn Khuzaymah. Very early, the Sheikh of Bukhari and Muslim. Kitab al-Tawheed by al-Bukhari in his book, Sahih al-Bukhari. Okay, beautiful.